Welcome, this is Information Service Engineering, lecture number 8, Knowledge Graphs, part 3. In this section of the lecture, we are going deeper into Sparkle. So this is the last Sparkle section of the lecture. So therefore, we are doing the more complicated stuff here then. So let's have a look. What we are going to do here now is we want to query not only one Sparkle endpoint, we want to do a federation of queries, which means federated query on two or more Sparkle endpoints. Let's have a look at our example. We know already two knowledge graphs that we can apply here. So we have DBpedia on one hand side, and on the other side, we have Wikidata, and we want to connect both in a single query. What is the question? What is the example we want to perform? So the query is, which mountaineers died on Mount Everest ordered by the death date? I admit this is a bit macabre, but it works. So you have a category in Wikipedia which says mountaineering deaths on Mount Everest, which means this is also available in DBpedia. So we are looking for all of the items which have as a subject mountaineering deaths on Mount Everest, because these are the people who have died on Mount Everest. And then we are connecting exactly these items with their counterpart, their corresponding items in Wikidata, via our same as, which means this is exactly the same as another thing here in Wikidata. And here in Wikidata, we are looking for the death date. This is via the property WDTP570, and this is then the death date. Let's have a look at the query. What is new here? We have, or we know already here, the keyword service. We had this already in Wikidata when we were using the label service. Here we are using the Sparkle endpoint as a service, which means we give here in angle brackets here the URI of the Sparkle endpoint of which this service directive aims for. First of all, in red here we have DBpedia. This is the URI of the DBpedia Sparkle endpoint. And in blue we have here the service directive for Wikidata, and this is the URI of the Sparkle endpoint, the Wikidata query service. Okay, and then encapsulated here again in curly brackets, we have here now our first in red, the Sparkle query to DBpedia. And we are asking here for items which have the subject DBC mountaineering deaths on Mount Everest. And they should be exactly the same like the Wikidata item below. And of course, in DBpedia, there are lots of same as directive, which means this connects not only to Wikidata, it also connects to other kind of services. So therefore, we are looking for a URI which contains the word wikidata.org, which, because this is then the same item in Wikidata and not in some other knowledge graph. So we have here a filter, regular expression, applied on the string in WDItem, and this should contain wikidata.org. So therefore, this filter expression here. First part on DBpedia. Then the blue part on Wikidata. There, what we are going to do is we are looking for a variable we call WDItem, and we say, okay, this should have a death date. And we say, okay, optionally, we want also to have an image. And all of this, then we want to have, of course, the label of that guy who died there. And we want to have, of course, the readable name in English, in natural language given here. So the other service directive won't work in a federated query so far. So this doesn't work on the Wikidata Sparkle endpoint if we use here the label directive as a service directive here. So therefore, we are simply using the old-fashioned form that we simply look this person, what's the RDFS label of this person, and we filter it then for English. Okay, so let's try it out. And of course, everything then is ordered by date. Let's go here to the Sparkle endpoint. You see here we have it, and we have also already make a visualization as a timeline, because we have here a date. Dates always can be shown in a timeline because they can be ordered sequentially, and it's also ordered by date here. And if possible, we also will see an image of that person. And you see this was pretty fast. So we have 42 results here, which does not mean that only 42 persons might have died on Mount Everest. It's only the persons which are as well in DBpedia. And in DBpedia, they are mentioned under this category that we are looking for. And they have a corresponding item in Wikidata. Then they are there. And you see here, one of the first died on Mount Everest. This is George Mallory, famous mountaineer. And it's not clear whether he has died on the 8th. On June 8, 1924 or on June 9, 1924. Therefore, they give both dates as potential death dates of that guy. Okay, so this was a federated Sparkle query. What else can we do? Let's have a look forward. What we can do in Sparkle is we can directly assign variables. And then use these variables again for further filtering or further more complicated stuff we want to do. So we have the following example for you. Here we are going to select authors and their notable works. We know that already. And the date of their publication. And we want to order this simply by the year of the publication, not necessarily by the entire date. So how are we doing this? Here we can do it in the following way. So we have here a year then also in our output variables. However, we cannot access the year directly. We can access here, as you see here, the publication date, which is a complete date, which consists usually of a year, a month, and a day. So there is the possibility to extract the year. So this is one of the operators we can use that can be applied, of course, on any date format. So year of something, this then will be in integer, the year extracted from the date format. And we bind here exactly the result of this operation, so of the year in integer, to a new variable that we call year. So we use bind, and here in parentheses we use s. So this expression then will be bound to the variable year, which is a new variable, which I can here also see here and use here and use it in exactly my output variable assignment. I do a bit more here. I filter again only. I want to see, of course, those who have a year here really. So sometimes they might have a year and the year is empty. And I only want to see them in the result where the year is not empty. So I look for those where the year really is bound to an expression. And again, then what I can do, since it appears here, the year variable in my output variables, I can order exactly by that expression. So I couldn't write here order by year of date. I have to use a variable here. That's the point. Okay, so let's see how this works in the end. So here we have again our Wikidata Sparkle query service, and I simply try to run it here where I want to select all of the books and of course all of the authors, their notable works, and I want to bind here, or I want to order them simply by the year. And this might take a while because this might be quite a number of notable works that are available there. You see here it's more than 10,000, it's 13,000 results here. And what you see here again in the results, we have here an author label and we have a book label. And yeah, it starts, of course, it's ordered then by publication year. And if this year has been published 2000 years before Christ, then of course, this is a rather early book we have here by N. Hedwana. Sorry, I don't know that author. I know Hesiod, so this is a Greek author. He has written Theogony and many other things, The Shield of Heracles, and so on and so on. So you see here, these are the antique books, and then there come newer books. They are all ordered by exactly here the publication date. Okay, so this was an interesting query where we have used binding of variables. What else can we do if we have bound a variable? So you see here again also in the presentation the potential result that we had achieved. What we can do with these new variables is we can use aggregate functions. What are aggregate functions? So for example, I can count the number of results instead of, you know, outputting every result. And I also can combine these counts or these aggregations then with other query expressions. So if I want to know how many authors are there and how many notable works, then I simply can write an expression like that. So count is here a Sparkle aggregate function, which counts the number of times a given expression has a bound. So we select, and then of course we have the variable assignment already here in the output assignment list, and we modify here the output by using here that aggregation function count on the variable book. And since here the constraint is it must be a variable, we have to assign it a new variable, which means here we doing here count book as book count. So book count is then our first variable name we have here, and the second one will be count of distinct authors. So again, count distinct is also new. I will show you then where it's for as author count. The point is sometimes more than one work per author is notable. And of course, we do not want to count authors who have two notable works there double or thrice. So therefore, we use the keyword distinct. And what distinct does, it only counts those author names which are distinct from each other. So if an author occurs twice, he's only counted once if you are using distinct. The rest is like in the first line. You see here, we assign a new variable author count to the expression count distinct author. And then we have here authors who have authored a written work. And then as book we have here, it should be a notable work. So book should be a notable work. And we are using here again the labeled service, which focuses on the language of English. Okay, let's try it out and see what will be the result. And you see here, notable works, we have 18,149 registered or contained in Wikidata, but they are only written by 9,518 authors. So most of these authors seem to have written at least two books. Interesting, and we found it out in that simple way. There are more aggregation functions, so you cannot only count, you can also, if there are numbers, simply sum them up, so you can build the sum. If there are numbers, you can average them with the average directive. If there are numbers, you can look for the minimum and the maximum, or you can simply choose an arbitrary sample entry as an aggregation function. So this was the aggregate part. Okay, we can further go on, and if we are aggregating stuff, I can show you how to use this by grouping then and dividing into groups and count inside these single groups within a Sparkle query. So for example, if we want to know which author exactly wrote how many notable works, because in the last query we only had the overall aggregate, we now want to know for each single author how many works she or he has written, then we of course need again a count expression. However, we want to know also which author has written how many books. So in the select clause, what we will have first here in an aggregate function is we will have a book count. Again, we count the books as book count. We combine this with the author label, and we aggregate this over the author labels by grouping it according to the author label. So this is a new directive, new keyword, group by. And this does nothing else but putting together all authors who have the same name, the same author label. And for them, for this author, all of the book entries, they are counted here. And then you have per author one line in the result with a number, which gives you exactly the number of books. And since we want to know, of course, who has written the most books, then we order this in a descending manner. And we order this by book count in a descending way. Okay, so let's see how this works. We have the query here, group by author label. So this is the first one, and for each of them, we want to count the books as a book count, and we order it descending by book count. So let's see how long this takes. We know there are more than 10,000 books. So we have a bit of time and then we see the result. Okay, since we only have 9,500 authors and some of them have written more than one book, you see here the top leading author according to Wikidata. So this is the author where Wikidata refers to the most notable works. This is Thomas Mann, German author, and they count 57 notable works. This is really a lot. Enid Blyton, also is a Swedish author, interesting, 55 notable works. Woody Allen, 49. Marion Zimmer Bradley, this is fantasy, 46. Elmore Leonard, I don't know, unfortunately, but Stephen King, of course, I know then with 36. So look around, this is quite an interesting list that they provide here. So this was the aggregation function. Sparkle 1.1 provides even more aggregation function. You know this already. So we have the sum, we have the average, we have minimum, we have maximum, and we have two more. You can look them up in the reference. So this is the sample or the group concat. Group concat gives you the possibility to put all of the results together and connect them via a connector value, which is, for example, a comma or a blank and so on. And you put them all then in one line if you want to do that. So this is group concat for creating nice results. But look it up if you want to do this. We don't have to do this together here. However, Sparkle is more than just a query language, because with Sparkle you cannot only select the data, you can also ask question whether there is a result or not. You do this via the ask directive. You can with Sparkle construct new RDF triples, so this you do via construct. You can ask for a description of specific entities, then you get all of the statements, all of the triples that are available for a specific entity. So this is the query part. But what you also can do then in your queries, you can do so-called subqueries and property paths. So probably we have time in the lab course, then we can show you this. But this is, of course, then Sparkle for experts in the end. And of course, since it's a full-fledged, not only query language, what you can do with Sparkle is you can, of course, also change and update your knowledge base, which means you can use an insert or delete statement for inserting and deleting RDF triples. And you can even create an entire RDF graph. You can drop a graph, you can copy a graph, or you can move a graph. So there are lots of things. And on the other hand, since we are dealing here not only with data, but with semantic expressions, you can use entailment. And there is also entailment for RDFS and OWL, which is included in Sparkle. So you can, for example, create transitive closures and can do really entailment in your queries. That this, of course, implicit knowledge is also respected and also taken into consideration. But this differs by implementation, also depends on the knowledge graph, how much knowledge is implemented in there. And therefore, of course, this is again something for experts. But taking into account these three sections of the lecture where we did Sparkle, you should now be totally able to write your own Sparkle queries on top of a knowledge base like DBpedia or Wikidata. And we will, of course, do many exercises related to that then in the lab courses. Okay, that was everything about Sparkle in this lecture. In the next lecture, we are going to talk about the web ontology language, where we can really then define ontologies in a much more elaborate and expressive semantic way.